The advice and opinions expressed by the host of Autism Live and her guests are meant solely as suggestion and should not be in any way construed as child-specific advice. The Center for Autism and Related Disorders advises working with a board-certified behavior analyst who has experience with autism before starting any intensive behavioral intervention. Any choices you make in determining your child's treatment are completely at your own discretion.
Good morning and welcome to Autism Live. I'm Shannon Penrod. We're coming to you live from the Warner Center in Woodland Hills, California. This is the home for the Center for Autism and Related Disorders headquarters. It's also the new home for Autism Live. We're thrilled to be here with you on this Wednesday morning. You know, on Wednesdays we have a two-part show. The first hour we have Ask Dr. Doreen. Dr. Doreen Grandbuchet is here with us in the studio live. She's going to be answering your questions in just a few minutes. We're very thrilled about that. In our second hour today, Let's Talk Autism with Shannon and Nancy. Nancy Allspot Jackson will be joining me, and our very special guest today will be Dan Healy. He is the filmmaker behind a new film, a documentary called Finding Joshua. We're going to talk about how Nancy is very connected to this story, a boy named Joshua Robb who went missing a few years ago. It's a documentary covering that. And Nancy's a part of the story. In fact, it's how she came to do Let's Talk Autism with Shannon and Nancy with me. So we're going to be talking with Dan Healy about that and what that has to do with the rest of you, because it's a story that touches all of us and is something that we all need to be aware of. So that'll be in the second hour. But in this first hour, we're hoping that you're going to participate with us and ask some questions from Dr. Doreen Grandbuchet. I do like to remind you at the start of the show that the entire program is meant to be interactive. Kelby is going to show you some of the different ways that you can get in touch with us here and some of the different ways that you can be watching the show. While he does that, I want to remind you that our homepage is autism-live.com. Many, many, many things to do when you go there, but one of the greatest things you can do is watch the live show or a recorded show. If you click on the triangle, it will show you, if we're live at that time, it'll show you the live show, or it'll show you the most recently recorded live show. If you go up into the upper left-hand corner of the computer screen, you will see a memo. It looks just like a little memo icon. If you click on that, you can watch any one of the most recent 100 shows that we've done here, and it allows you to fast forward, pause, and rewind. It's a great, great feature. To the side of all that is the live feature. If you will put your cursor in the box that says your question, all you have to do is type and hit enter. That's it. You don't have to log in. You don't have to remember a password. You don't have to click that little thing that says forgot password and wait for an email. There's none of that. And it's totally free. It's totally anonymous. So please use that feature. Give us as much information as you can. By the way, if you there is a certain number of characters it will hold you to, you can always keep typing and make it the second part. Or if that's inconvenient for you, you can always email me at s.penrod@autism-live.com. We look forward to your questions and we look forward to your answers, quite frankly. In any case, it is time now for Ask Dr. Doreen.
Dr. Doreen Grandbuchet is the
Dr. Doreen is an expert in autism.
Doreen Grandbuchet.
Dr. Grandbuchet.
Dr. Doreen Grandbuchet.
Dr. Doreen Grandbuchet is a visionary in the field of autism. Now you can ask her questions on Ask Dr. Doreen.
Welcome to Ask Dr. Doreen. We welcome Dr. Doreen Grandbuchet.
Good morning.
You're looking particularly lovely today.
Oh, thank you so much.
Thrilled to have you with us this morning. And for our regulars, we all love you so much. But for people just joining us, I want to let them know that you are an expert in the field of autism, having been working in this field for 30 years, and that you have worked with all types of individuals on the autism spectrum, from very young children up through adults. And I think that you are the preeminent expert in this field. You have been able to help so many individuals, everything from getting the most progress that they can up through recovery. And that's something that we will talk about today, is that there is recovery from autism, that that's not a myth. And you've been able to help more individuals, I think, than probably anybody else on the planet to achieve that.
I don't know, but we've had quite a few, I'm happy to say.
Yes. And I also believe that, I know you are a visionary in this field.
You Thank see you very
things,
much, Sean.
This field has changed so much over the years, and you see things coming, and you're able to help prepare us for those things that are coming. So we're thrilled to have you for this hour.
Thank you very much.
Answering individuals' questions that come in. We want to remind everybody that you know, equal opportunity. If you're on the spectrum yourself, great to write in these questions. If you're
Absolutely.
A parent, a practitioner, a teacher, we welcome everybody's questions.
Absolutely.
We do like to remind you, however, that there is no expert in any field that can answer individual specific questions in this format. So we do want to let people know that you're going to be giving some broad directions, more questions for people to ask. But that you can't give individual specific advice. It would be unfair to the individual.
Absolutely.
So wonderful. We're gonna start off. We have some questions left over from last week that I want to get to, but we've got questions that came in this morning, and I'm on a treadmill today. We're gonna get as much done as we can.
Go fast.
I'm gonna get stuff done. Okay. Good morning to you all. I'm a parent of a 4-year-old on the spectrum from Compton, California. He goes on to say, I'm not sure if this is related to the advice Dr. Doreen is giving, because remember, this was written during last week's show. Mm-hmm. I have a similar situation with my child in regards to tantrums and meltdowns. My son has a speech delay, so it makes it hard to ask him what the problem is. My son seems to not be able to hear the word no or stop from both his mother and I. Out in public, it's the same. No one can tell him no or stop if he runs off crying. We went as far as not using the word, but I felt that would not solve the problem. I'm now persuading him before we tell him no, but it is hard to do so at a public place when he doesn't have it his way. What other methods can I practice? The conversation of not taking my son shopping has arisen. I don't feel it's right, and I feel as though I'm taking from his childhood. Any suggestions?
So I'm interpreting some of this question,
yes.
and I'm guessing that this dad is saying that when the son hears the word no, he falls apart or has some sort of tantrum, is what I'm guessing.
Yes, because that was a question that we had last week.
Okay.
Yes, so exactly.
Right, so this is really important. I wish I had a little diagram here and I could pull up and write all the behavioral stuff on here. But so when we look at the behavior, let's look at the behavior of tantruming, right? And you say no, and the child tantrums or has any kind of negative reaction, and then generally speaking, you will back off. You will not force the issue.
Right.
So in other words, you'll back off. And what happens is that the child learns that their tantrum was very effective in getting you to back off.
And can I just say that that's a normal reaction for parents when you're in public and you see your child escalating and you know it's going to go into a tantrum. It is, you know, a normal reaction for us that we do back off.
Yeah.
It isn't what's going to serve us well, as
right.
you're saying.
Right.
But I just want to point out that we all do it. We don't need to be defensive about it. We've all done it at some point.
Absolutely. Absolutely. And so what I'm trying to get to is that instead of you shaping the behavior of your child is shaping your behavior. So you now become afraid of saying the word no because you think that every time you say no, there's going to be this negative thing, which is the child's tantrum. So the child now taught you to never say the word no. Okay, so we have to change this because you can't parent any child without having the power to let them know what is okay and what is not okay. That's just bottom line. And the nicest way to let a child know that something is not okay is to tell them no. So the bigger issue is we have two issues here. One is, how do we help you cope with the tantrum that occurs, because we want to reduce your behavior. We want to reduce your learned behavior of avoiding the word no. We want to alter that. We want you not to avoid that word. So first we have to work with that, with you on that. And then after we get you to say no without fear, then we have to make sure that it actually is effective and it means something to your child. Okay, so how do we do those things? First, for both purposes, we pick the simplest, easiest possible situation, not something in public, not something abstract or complicated or confusing. We pick something that is a very basic thing. For instance, I don't know, you don't want your child to turn on the water. I'm just picking something that's manageable and easy like that. So you will stand there. It has to be a small task. It has to be a small behavior and something that you can control. So you stand there and the child is tempted by being shown the object. Let's say you don't want your child to take a cookie, or you don't want your child to turn on water. Whatever it is, you tempt the child. You put the object there and the child reaches for it and you say no, and you hold the child's hand. That's really as simple as it is. And you will remove the item, put it somewhere else, and move on. And you do this 10 times, 20 times, it doesn't matter. Now what will happen is your child will freak out, cry, tantrum, hit you, do all these sorts of stuff. And this is where you will exercise what's called extinction, which means you actually ignore all of it. In fact, the best way I find for parents to actually really ignore all of it is to walk away. Because generally when parents are there, they have a very hard time really ignoring a behavior. They talk to the child, they comment on it, they'll say stuff like, well, you're not supposed to hit me, no, you're not supposed. That's all not extinction. What I mean ignore, I mean ignore. I mean the behavior didn't occur. So again, let's reiterate here. So you will have you'll set up a small situation that's easily manageable, that you'll tempt the child to do a behavior that you don't want them to. As they approach the behavior, you will block the behavior physically by holding the child's hand or blocking their access, and you will say no. Just like that, and then when the child will maybe turn around to you, hit you, maybe freak out, whatever, you will ignore it. You'll stop. You won't do anything. When the child has stopped crying, tantruming, or aggressing, if they continue to cry, tantrum, or aggress, you walk away. When they've stopped, you'll place the object again, and you'll have the child be tempted again, and you'll again say no. By doing this repeatedly and by doing various behaviors, not just the same target behavior, but various things, the child will learn the meaning of the word no. Would you want to just jump in?
I just wanted to say what's really pivotal to me here,
yes,
and what
yes,
you're
please.
Saying is that you're doing this at home, separate from the event that is causing you the problem. It's almost like, you know, a figure skater, in order to be ready to do the triple toe loop, practices the figure eights on the skating rink at 5 o'clock in the morning that nobody ever sees.
That's right.
This is the figure eight that nobody is ever gonna see. It's totally manageable. You've set it up, you're creating the environment so that you're just gonna practice, you're gonna build this muscle with the child.
Exactly.
So that you can do it out
exactly.
in public at some point. So, because I think a lot of times we think, well, I'm gonna do it, you know, what we call in vivo, I'm gonna do it at the grocery store.
Right. That's right.
You know,
that's
too right. many variables.
And it's so important. What Shannon is talking about is really, it's ABA, you eventually generalize it to the real world. But the reason that we insist on a very intensive program of ABA is because you have to take all these particular scenarios and practice them one-on-one in a very sort of safe and benign environment where nothing can happen, nothing bad can happen. If you're doing this in outside, a million bad things could happen.
Yeah.
So it's a very controlled environment. And again, like, you know, touching the water, grabbing for a cookie, taking a toy. How old is the child? 4-year-old. Very easy.
Yeah.
There will be so many things that are easy to set up. And you specifically are setting up that situation because you want the child to learn that your child is intelligent. They will understand that when they hear the word no, and that's paired with you actually physically blocking them from doing something, It means you cannot have this object, yeah. Period. Yeah. Now, that's just one type of no, and there's many different types of no. For instance, the child might try to hit someone else, like another child, and that is also another scenario where you would hold the child's hand and say no. All you're really doing is you're pairing the verbal instruction, no, with the blocking of the behavior. The behavior could be anything. It could be grabbing something. It could be hitting someone. It could be trying to run away. Whatever it is, when you say no, you have to prevent that behavior at the same time. You have to block the hand. You have to get in front of the other child. You have to prevent the child from running away. So all that sort of stuff is how you pair and give meaning to the word no. Now, the other portion, of course, that's very, 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 very important is not giving in when your child actually reacts in a negative way. Now, your child may have the longest tantrum of his life. You will be shocked at how long a child can scream and cry. I have had children who, over just the word no, have cried for 2 hours and then fallen asleep from exhaustion. So that doesn't matter. Now, this is very important. If you reward the child in any way, if you communicate with the child during the tantrum, if you give in and give them the object during the tantrum, if you do any of those things, you've now made the situation worse than it was before. You've now taught the child that they won't get what they want unless they have a 45-minute tantrum. Now the child thinks, if they say no to me, and they prevent me from getting something, all I have to do is scream for 45 minutes. So you're teaching them a new bad behavior. So make sure you do not give in. This is very, very important. And it's hard. I mean, fortunately, you have a 4-year-old. We sometimes do this with 18-year-olds. Yeah. That's hard. But when you have a 4-year-old, really, they're not going to be... What will happen is you'll have a few pretty extreme tantrums, and then gradually the child will realize the tantrums don't have any effect.
Yeah.
And as soon as the child realizes the tantrum is ineffective in changing your behavior, they'll stop. And this is probably the single most important parenting skill for any parent, is to be able to go through and ignore the tantrums of our children.
I always love to, when I do talks, tell the story of the second therapist that ever came to our door, who looked like he was 17 years old. He came in board shorts and flip-flops, and I thought, what is this child going to teach me about?
Right.
You know? And he happened to be the therapist who was there. My son was hitting his head on the kitchen floor on a regular basis.
Mm-hmm.
And he happened to be the first therapist that was there when it happened. It was at the end of his session. I thought he was going to leave. I even said to him very nastily, oh, I bet you're out of here now, right?
Mm-hmm.
Right when I need you the most. He said, no, I've already called into the office. I'm going to stay, and I'm going to help you through this. And I said, oh, great. And I lifted up my hands, and I said, then you deal with it. And I mm-hmm. went to leave, and he said, no, that's not how this is going to happen. I'm going to be the voice in your ear, and I'm going to talk you through it, and you're going to do what I tell you to do, but I'm not going to talk to your child at all. You're going to talk to your child or not talk to your child. And my child was tantruming. We secured the area first, made it safe, and then he had me watering plants.
Mm-hmm.
My child was flipping out, pulling on my pants, screaming, trying to hit me, and he was like, water some more plants. Now open the mail.
Mm-hmm.
And I thought he was crazy. I quite honestly thought he was crazy.
Right.
And it went on for 20 minutes. Until I was having a meltdown myself. I was laughing and crying and saying to this look like 17-year-old young man, I'm going to wet my pants.
Yeah.
I was a mess.
Yeah.
And if I had been there by myself, I wouldn't have made it through it. I can tell you. And he said to me exactly what he said. I've been timing this. It's been 22 minutes. He's getting tired.
Mm-hmm.
If you give in now, the next time this will be 40 minutes. Or if you can hang in with me, he's almost done.
Right.
And he may never hit his head on the kitchen floor again.
Right. Right.
And he built me up so that I could, and that was the last time that Jem ever hit his head on the kitchen floor.
Right.
And I went, oh, okay, this ABA thing works.
Oh, yeah.
It was hard. And he was
probably the hardest.
He was
thing.
Three. But I see people now dealing with 17-year-olds having to learn this lesson, and I think, thank goodness I did this when he was 3.
That's right.
We don't have to deal with this
That's
now.
Right.
And as hard as it was, and seriously, I was laughing, crying, snot running down my face, and thinking I was going to wet my pants.
Right.
And a mess. That is easier than dealing with it later on.
Absolutely. And sometimes you look back at those times and it's a little bit traumatic still when you look back at those things. But the fact is, it's over.
It's over.
And it ended, you know, 10 years ago versus lifelong. And some of our children, it is only one of the things that I learned early on with ABA is just to be able to say behavior is communication. Challenging behavior is communication. When a child hits their head on the floor, all they're really saying, if they could vocalize it, would be to say, you think I can't freak you out? This is how angry I am. I'm going to do something to hurt myself and it's going to freak you out. And you're going to let me get away with whatever I was doing. And truly, if it doesn't freak you out, and if you just keep doing your own thing, the child is smart and will realize, well, that didn't work.
Yeah.
I should try something else. Maybe next time I should try asking for stuff.
Yeah.
And that's when, of course, ABA teaching comes in and you replace it with an appropriate request.
But I think you've outlined exactly for what this parent to do. So important that you have your ducks in a row so you're ready to follow through. It's not when you have to be at a meeting in 15 minutes that you do this. It's
not
when
at all.
When you've cleared your decks.
You need a half day for this so that you can handle it.
And maybe you need help and support. Line
maybe
up whatever you need to do to make that happen. But it's a worthwhile thing to get it done and get it done right early. And I especially want to address that, you know, sometimes we'll talk about while you're doing this, maybe this is not the day to take him out to the grocery store. But the fact of the matter is, if you get this in place, then later on in the week, you are going to be able to go to the grocery store and it's going to be a different thing.
Yeah.
It's not about keeping our kids shut in.
Right. And that's thank you for bringing that up, because I just read the last sentence, which is like, I don't feel right. I feel like I'm taking from his childhood. And, you know, you're not. Allowing this to go on is taking from his childhood, because when our kids are out of control, they're not able to merge with real life. The only reason, I mean, all kids tantrum, all children take some time, and sometimes adults take some time to learn to control themselves and regulate their own behaviors. But the truth is, the sooner we learn that, the better it is for us and social world and so on and so forth. So you're not, you're adding to his life by teaching him to not behave in a really bad way.
It's worth it. It's really worth it. Okay, I said we were going to go fast, but that was worthwhile taking that question. We're going to take a quick break. We're going to be back with some more questions. Stick with us.
It's every parent's desire for their child to have a great start in life. Yet there is a condition affecting more children's lives than pediatric cancer, diabetes, and AIDS combined. Autism strikes one in every 150 children.
Today, one in 110 kids in the U.S. will be diagnosed with autism. That is a huge jump from 30 years ago when it was one in 30,000.
A startling new report finds the number of children with autism is skyrocketing. The Centers for Disease Control estimates one in 68 children has a form of autism. Now that's a 30% increase in just 2 years.
Well, a lot of this has been all the accomplishments over the last 20 years. I'm thrilled.
I think what kept me was the feeling that, you know, I would have a parent come to my office late at night at UCLA and just fall apart. And this is a long time ago, and there were much less back then in terms of services and knowledge and so on. And I would just sit with the family and the parents and walk them through and try to take away some of their fears, you know. And at that point I realized, I think the thing that's actually most important to me is that process.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, thank God that I've been very, very lucky and blessed to have so many incredible clinicians join me along the way and just develop CARD in such an amazing, magnificent way. That I could, you know, for me it was more really about how can I help the families?
Mm-hmm.
What can I do for the moms, the dads, you know? It is just, and I feel like, you know, there's no way I would ever really know because I haven't had my own child go through this, but I've experienced it with people a lot of times.
Hi, this is Megan. I'm in first grade all by myself. My teachers are so fabulous. I like to read books. I like to go to my friends' birthday parties. I like to invite my friends to my birthday parties. once had a sleepover with a friend. I like to have play dates with my friend. I'm the best reader in my class. I like to go to the library. I like to read different series of books. And here's how I learned to do all these things. By my card friends and Dr. Grant Pichet. Thank you, card friends and Dr. Grant Pichet.
Welcome back to Autism Live and to Ask Dr. Doreen. Dr. Doreen Grampuchet is here with us. She's answering your questions in real time. I'm going to move on to this question that came in from Puerto Rico. Thank you. I saw that and I interpreted it. We had a follow-up to the tantrum question, a really good question. Somebody said, what if the child follows you and grabs you while you're ignoring? And thanks for the details, because that is what happens.
Yes, absolutely. If the child follows you and hits you, is that what it
grabs
was?
You, grabs like you. Like Jem was grabbing my pants and trying to pull them down.
That is even further confirmation that the child is only doing that behavior for your attention. Like they're only doing it to get you upset. So I hate to say this, but you still have to keep ignoring. So you will walk, let them follow you. You will walk and do something else. You'll watch TV, you'll read a book, you'll open the mail, you'll vacuum, you just go about your life. And once they have stopped, and to, you know, let's say for a period of 10 seconds so they can take a breath, that's when you engage. And then that's when you go in and start doing something completely different. You don't talk about what just happened at all. You just get involved with something else and move on.
Yeah.
So that is the truth of, that is the real way that we call ignoring extinction, is like you really, the behavior didn't happen.
Yeah. Yeah. At one point I was watering the plants and going around the living room watering the plants, and Jem had a hold of my leg and I was walking and dragging him along behind me as if nothing was happening, which is why I started, you know, crying and laughing, because it was ridiculous. I was like, this is against everything I've ever learned, but it worked.
That you have to have in some young person telling you what to do when it goes against everything that you've ever, is very, very hard.
But these young so-and-sos, they know what they're doing. So listen to them, because they're brilliant. They've been trained under Dr. Grampuchet. They know what they're doing. Okay, I want to move on to a question from Puerto Rico. I just moved from Puerto Rico to get some help since my 8-year-old son has autism. Don't know how to start. I got Medicaid, and his plan is stay well. I've been seeing a pediatric, and I don't know what the word is, but someone in pediatric, and she referred for therapy and doctors. He doesn't speak. He's in a public school and ran out of the school 2 times already, on December 11th, 2015, and already on January 12th, 2016. My question is, what else is there to do to keep him on track since we recently moved?
Okay. So you have to get complete coverage for your child. I mean, this is what I would consider a pretty serious situation, because you have an 8-year-old and he has no sense of communication. So you, for a child like this, I would ask for complete all day long coverage. Now, he is in school, I can see, and it sounds like it's a special education school. The school is responsible for this type of thing. The school has to have a shadow aide with him, so that he's never allowed to run away. The fact that he has already run away twice in a month is pretty serious, and the school can get into very significant trouble because of that. So you need to do 2 things. You will call, you will go to your school, and you'll ask the principal for what's called an IEP, Individualized Education Plan. It's a meeting. And they will set up the meeting, and you have to push it. So you have to ask for an emergency IEP, because your child's running away. So this is it's a safety issue, so they will pay attention. They'll give you an IEP meeting, and the school teacher will be there, and the principal, and all these people. And you will say, my child has run away twice, he's not safe, and I need a one-to-one full-time shadow with him here in school, and I want that person to be ABA trained. Okay, so it's a fight. You'll have to get them to give you a shadow, and you'll have to make sure the shadow is trained. So that'll take care of what you can get for school. Now, in addition, through your Medicaid plan, through Stay Well, you should be able to get ABA therapy at home the rest of the time. So if he gets home from school at, let's say, 3 o'clock, from 3 until he sleeps and all weekend long, he needs someone with him doing therapy, doing ABA therapy, teaching him how to communicate, teaching him what behaviors are okay, teaching him safety skills, all of this type of stuff. Now, if you want to contact us, and I don't know where you've moved to, but if you want to contact CARD, you just call the number that's on our website, and you will be able to access our contracts department, and they will be able to give you some help when it comes to how you request this information and this funding from your insurance. So your insurance would fund, let's assume he sleeps at, 9 o'clock at night. So maybe 5 hours a day of ABA during the week, that's 15, and another 15 hours during the weekend. So we would request 30 hours of funding from your insurance, from Medicaid plan, and you would get 30 hours of one-to-one ABA at school with a shadow. So he's covered 60 hours a week.
So if you need more help and support, make sure that you reach out to us, but call that 800 number for the CARD 800 number to see if there's one that's close to you.
That's right.
Super duper important. Okay, I want to move on. Dear Shannon and Dr. Doreen, we have an effective token system for our 15-year-old who's high functioning. Last night he asked when we can discontinue the token system. I didn't know what to say and told him he can propel himself. The token system is very powerful as an external motivator for socialization, anxiety, and studying. If the tokens are removed, how can we continue to work on those skills to help him thrive in life? He wants to be independent and is working towards it. Would like to keep the token system, but also want to respect his wishes as an individual, and they want to know our thoughts. And this comes to us from our haircut mom.
That's awesome. I love that he wants to get rid of the token system. I would ask him why he wants to get rid of the token system. My impression is that he may think that it is too young or too restrictive for him. In other words, he thinks himself higher than needing a token system, and he might be embarrassed by it. So if that's the case, I would allow him, first of all, to take control of the token system. In other words, I would allow him to self-administer the tokens and self-administer the rewards, just to have him take a little bit more charge of it. So he would be the one, you would stand with him, and let's say you would say, so did you accomplish this, and then should you get a token or not? And he would say yes or no, and he would give himself the token. So let him take complete control over administration of the token for a little while. And then after that, maybe move the token system to his room, to a place that's private, maybe inside his closet. And after that, every few days, stop using the token system. Let him, ask him to please continue using it, even if you can't be there. So just say something like, I can't do it right now, but can you go do your token system? And he should easily be able to do it. And if once he starts to do that, you gradually will become absent as he maintains the token system, and then it becomes a private matter. If he continues to maintain his socialization, if his anxiety is low, if he's following through and continues to study, then you don't need the token system. And he will either maintain it, internalize it and maintain it, or he won't, in which case it doesn't matter because he's still keeping up with all the things he was before. Now, if he doesn't keep up with it, then that's the time when you come back and say, you didn't study, I need to maintain the token system, I will let go of it if you keep studying. And he'll understand. I mean, it sounds like he's very high functioning and can really understand this dialogue, but it is important to respect his wishes, but also realize that token systems can be different in form. You don't have to have an actual token board with stickers on it and so on, you know? A lot of people use a journal, and they list. I list things on my phone, and then I check them off. And that is a token system for all practical purposes, because when I check them off or I cross them out, it immediately gives me a sense of gratification. And also, it allows me, when I go home and I've crossed off the 10 things I was supposed to do today, I immediately tell myself, well, that's great. I accomplished what I wanted to accomplish, or I accomplished most of what I wanted to accomplish. It's time for me to relax. So if you really think about it, that is a token system. I've done what I was supposed to, and I'm going to give myself a reinforcer. So really, the whole concept of setting up token systems for our kids is just to teach them to regulate themselves this way, and it's kind of a visual board to help them with that. And the sooner you can get rid of that and internalize it, the better.
Yeah, I'll tell you, the token system that we have now with Jem is called allowance. Mm-hmm. And he gets paid
there
allowance when he does the things that he's supposed to
go.
Do. And we don't, sometimes I feel like it's a little too loosey-goosey, but it isn't, because it maintains it. And if I see things slipping, I'll just say, I'll have to take that out of your allowance. And he's Johnny on it.
Oh,
it's
yeah,
money.
Absolutely.
Money talk.
I mean, why do we go to work?
I mean,
we go to work mostly. I mean, most of the time we go to work just because we absolutely need that money. So that's a token system. You know, everything in life is pretty much based on this system.
It's but if you ask Jem would not know that it was a token system. He's just like, I get an
allowance
like everybody else.
That's right.
And it's my pay.
That's right. And it takes away the sort of stigma.
Yeah.
And that's a very good idea, in fact, for a 15-year-old, that you identify an allowance and certain things are intended. You just identify, okay, I need you to do your homework every night, and that'll be $5. And if you do, you know, this, that, and the other thing, and it allows the token system to go on in a more acceptable manner.
Yeah, money speaks. Okay, we're going to take a short break, and we're going to be back with more Ask Dr. Doreen. Stick with us.
Hello there, fellow activist. You're an activist because you're making the world a better place for someone living with autism. Now on Autism Live, you learn all about your children. You learn about their bodies and their brains. But this empowerment moment is all about you. It's about your heart and your soul. Now don't worry, I'm not going to have you start singing Kumbaya or doing chanting. Let's talk about blessings. One of the blessings of living with a child with autism is learning to love them unconditionally. Learning to love them despite all the ups and downs, all the sacrifices. In fact, you learn to love them more so because of them. I call this my empowerment prayer. God grant me the wisdom to see my disability as an opportunity, the courage to love my child unconditionally, and the faith to live a life of purpose. So going from the sublime to the ridiculous, I have a little song for you today. It's a rap song, so I know that an old middle-aged white woman rapping just doesn't seem right, but I'm gonna go for it anyway. My style is a little like Nicki Minaj meets Dr. Seuss. Nancy's Autism Rap. It's just a diagnosis, your life's not over. Don't lay there like a dog, get up, Rover. You say your head is spinning with GF, CF, ABA, IEPs, and neurofeedback? Autism tough, that much is true, but you'll survive because you're you. Your life's not over, it's just begun, so walk out that door and go be someone. More Dr. Seuss than Nicki Minaj. Until next time, stay strong and keep the faith.
Welcome back to Autism Live and to Ask Dr. Doreen. Dr. Doreen Grampuchet is here with us, and she's answering your questions in real time. We had a momentary glitch on the live feature, but we are back back live. Somebody wants to say congrats on the West LA office opening. Would services be center-based for a high-functioning teen? Thank you and have a wonderful day.
Thank you for that question. I'm not sure if it would be all center-based for a high-functioning teen. It really depends on what the person's needs are. So let me just think. If I have a high-functioning teen, some of the services might be center-based. and some of them would be home-based, but I would imagine that probably most of them would be community-based.
Yeah, that's what
so
I
So I'd have to kind of see what the issues are, but yeah, and thank you. Yeah, we're opening a lot of new offices.
Yes, very exciting. Okay, hello and good morning. I have a 7-year-old boy that is on the spectrum. He is in a regular education first grade room, but he is the lowest in his class. He has several interventions throughout his day, but what I noticed most is the retention. He can read words perfectly one day, forgets them the next day. He also forgets his friends' names frequently as well. What can I do to improve his memory? And thanks for your advice.
Oh boy.
I call this the dry erase board.
Mm-hmm.
Because Jem was like this a lot, and still, you know, from time to time we'll struggle with this, where we would drill something before we started ABA and even afterward, like somebody's name, like this is your Uncle Jerry, and he would have it, and then he would go to sleep, and it was like somebody erased the dry
erase
board.
I'm glad to hear that, because that makes me less concerned about it, because seeing Jem now, you know? So what I would do is, first of all, it's a good thing if your child is the lowest functioning in a classroom because they have higher level models, but it could also be a bad thing in that they feel left behind. So really your child would benefit pretty significantly from having a very good shadow in school who can help the child integrate and keep up. And then also, of course, the goal would be that all hours outside of school, the child would be learning new things so that they would continue to do better and excel. It's very, very important that you do not let the child fail. This is the beginning of the point where, like this, a lot of time in the old days, people would criticize me because I would keep my children out of school until they achieved a certain level of functioning, because I wanted to make sure that they are successful. The worst thing is that if a child enters a program at school and fails, because both for the child and for the system, it then becomes very difficult to erase that and say, you didn't fail, you're gonna do fine, and we're gonna make this a success. So let's make sure he doesn't fail. And the way to do that, obviously, is to have an aide with him and to really focus on teaching him the things he needs in order to succeed, whatever they may be, academic or behavioral or social, whatever they may be. Now, in terms of memory, I would first of all make sure you get an IQ test and he's 7 years old, so he would be getting what's called a WISC, Wechsler Intelligence Scale for Children, WISC. And the WISC is very good because it gives you subtests that actually look just at memory. And then you would find out what type of memory issue does he have. Is it short-term memory, long-term, episodic memory? Working memory? Working memory is a little bit different in functioning as other forms of memory. And then it would give you the idea. Once you know that, then those are the things you focus on teaching. Now, in our skills website, which is our curriculum, the CARD curriculum, there's a whole section on memory type activities in the cognition curriculum. So there's a lot of different types of things that help us increase memory. They're rote exercises. Anybody can do them, but it's a lot of exercise. It's just practice. Memorizing things. And there's mnemonic devices or ways to remember things that we try to advise people on. But having said that, the number one cause for us to not remember things is usually anxiety. So that's kind of an important thing to note, because you really have a very hard time maintaining active memory when you're anxious.
Fascinating.
And it gets better. Don't worry. Don't let it scare you. It does get better. But there are a lot of different ways to help memory.
And I can speak firsthand, the lessons and skills, that was what they did with Jem. And the truth of the matter is, and I know all kids are different, but just to give you a little hope, now at 12 and a half, Jem memorizes things faster than anybody else I know.
Right.
Because we worked on all those skills, he can memorize something, like, you know, he has no problem. They give him something in class, 2 paragraphs long. He looks it over and he can get up and do the whole thing and have it memorized. The teachers say to me frequently, they're like, wow, what's that about?
You know, and what's really interesting is that sometimes it's very, very hard to memorize things unless they sort of make sense to you.
Yes.
So like, just as an example, like if I was just to tell you to memorize, let's say, five words, and the words were table, chair, sofa, you know, or whatever, various aspects of furniture, you as someone who knows that these are all furniture would automatically classify them under furniture, and you'd visualize them as I was telling you. And that both of those things, classification and visualization, help memory. Now, if you don't know what these things are, you don't know that what the words are, and you don't know that they're all part of one category, it becomes very, very hard for you to memorize them. It's just gibberish. So the more meaning a word has and the more it has been classified under a different heading, the more we're able to remember those things so that you, because you can visualize them. And that's, and also kids have different ways of visualizing. Like as an example, you know, when I was working on French with my son last year, and it was hard. Like he just had a hard time memorizing French. On the same token, this is someone who can listen to a rap song of 10 minutes and memorize the entire thing verbatim. Yeah. So I know for him, anything that is fun or in a song format, he will learn immediately. That's why we put things in song. That's why we do things like, what is it? What's the song,
Head, Shoulders, Knees, and Toes,
right? Yeah. I mean, we do those things in order to help memory. So maybe find out what are the things that would help your child and try to use those things as well.
Yeah, I think it makes it rewarding. Mm-hmm. Okay, so we had a follow-up on from the Haircut Mom. Thanks for answering the token system question. Great ideas. Do we still limit access to rewards, like a sweet drink, and technology minutes? He's an honest kid and would cut down on tech to save the points for something else. And she says, you ladies rock.
Yeah, you would still maintain the system in the reward, you know, the actual reward ratio, but you would eliminate the token system itself or hide it under something. Now, if he, one of the things that's very important about a token system is what we call thinning the reinforcement schedule. So what you do is you, over a period of time, start to loosen the criteria and the contingencies. That's a completely different discussion than actually allowing him to take it over. Now, if you want to, if you feel like you want to gradually thin it out, then what you end up doing is you reduce the criteria and you increase the reinforcers to normal level. A token system, as I said, is just a visual reminder of what you can get. Now, let's assume that if he does his own homework, what you want is for him to just walk over, be able to get himself that sweet drink because he has now finished his homework. And if you can eliminate the visual cues, certainly let him do that, and then that's what we all do, all right? We do our work, and then we go get a snack. I've taught my kids that for years and years. It's like, first do 2 hours of homework, and then you can have a snack, then do another 2 hours, and then we'll go for a walk, you know? So helping a child, and he's 15, so certainly helping him identify how to break up his activities and fill his own life with various reinforcers is one of the most valuable things you could do for him.
Absolutely. You're going to set him up for success. Okay, I want to move on to this next question about after-school routine. Hello, Shannon and Dr. Doreen. I need help establishing an after-school routine. We have dinner at a different time every night, so how do I make a consistent routine? I have two kids, and homework turns into a battle since sometimes they get to play first and sometimes they have to work first. My one daughter has high-functioning autism and negotiates everything, that's all in capital letters, especially homework. She is winning and gets to delay it by at least 20 minutes with constant arguing. Once she starts, it's fine. Please help us and thank you. Sending you love.
Yes, yes, absolutely. So, you know, you in your paragraph, if you read your own paragraph, you see what the problem is. It's pretty clear, is that it's that section that says sometimes they get to play first and sometimes they have to work first. Now, that in itself is exactly why you have an issue. And I think that you need to just stick with one procedure and mandate that procedure come rain or shine. Like, that is the procedure. That's correct. But you do have a wonderful thing, which is, okay, no, and you have dinner at different times every night. That is also a problem. So, and let me say, this is very possible. I have three children, and I more or less raised them on my own. Now, here's what's very, very, very important. I established a dinner time of 6:30, and everyone had to be at the dinner table at 6:30, and more, you know, until they got into heavy classes in high school, their homework had to be finished by then. So that was it. That was the rule. And if you came to dinner at 6:30 and you had not finished your homework, it was your problem. You had to go back and finish your homework. I didn't care if I would check on their homework. I didn't care if they stayed up till 3 a.m. and had to go back to school. Their punishment was you have to finish your homework every night, and that's that. So with children, we have to be the ones to adhere to those rules ourselves. That's what's hard.
Yeah.
But let me tell you, they're now, one of them is in university and one of them is graduating in 4 months and the other one is in 10th grade and we still have dinner at 6:30. Like, it's so clear that that is a routine that we've established their whole lives, and it's there, and it is there. And we've changed things around a little bit, but after dinner, we're all together. We socialize. That's our time together. And sometimes dinner will be at 7, but that's about it. Like, it won't be later than that, because that's just how I regiment it. So it's very important for you to do that, is that what can you do before focusing on how to change their behavior? What can you do to change your routine?
Yeah.
Can you make dinner the same time every night? And can you make homework precede dinner, come before dinner? Then once you have a regular thing in place, it's hard for kids to adjust to different rules. That's almost impossible. So you really have to have one rule. Then what you have to do is put it on a visual thing. So put it on a board that says very simply, from this time to this time, and we don't know the children's ages. So, like, let's say from 3:30 till 4 is snack time. They're coming home from school. Then from 4 to 6, they do homework. But maybe you want to break it up even more than that and say, like, from 4 to 5, you do these subjects. From 5 to 6, you do these subjects. And then 6, you can play around a little bit. 6:30 is dinner. After that is whatever, TV time. Break up the whole, write it out. Now, if they're too young to actually be able to read what you've written and understand time, I really don't know their ages, then what you do is you take a picture of them doing that activity. So you'll take a picture of the person doing homework, and you put it up on this board in order. And you can time each segment. Like, for instance, when it's snack time, set a timer so that when the timer rings, you'll say, oh, guys, it's time to go to do homework now. And they go do their homework and set the timer. They have 1 hour to do this homework. After 1 hour, they'll get a little break. So help them by making it fun. Like, I always did this with my kids because it was fun for them to actually have a timer. And it was also very motivating for them to know that at the end of this session or when the timer is up, I get a reward. And, you know, for me now it's very easy because this is the whole, I can schedule their whole day this way. But when you first start out, you need to make it in very small chunks or increments. So you would have to say, I need you to do homework for 10 minutes. Here's a timer for 10 minutes. And then you'll get a toy for 5 minutes. Now you have another 10-minute segment. You have to shape this up so that they actually are compliant, and then they're rewarded on very specific schedule. So it's kind of, it really is just about organizing things for them and making it visual.
Okay, great. I've got time, so I want to go back to another question about mealtime.
Sure.
Happy New Year, Shannon and Dr. Doreen. Trying to get my team to tune in and participate in conversations during mealtime. He tends to focus on eating. Congratulations, because I have to rip a cell phone out of somebody's hands to get him to concentrate on eating. Tried reinforcing him using tokens, and he joined in. He tends to address one person and ask a question. Example, Mom, what do you mean by me, Mom, is not a good conversationalist? Short of kidnapping Shannon, how can we teach him? Thank you so much.
Kidnapping Shannon.
Oh, I see. So I know. I teach. I know. This is the hardest thing that I'm working. Like, Jem can hold a conversation, but getting him to is one of the hardest things that I face every single day. Once I get him completely removed from technology, he has conversations, and I always say to him, you know, it's so much fun for me to be able to talk with you. And that I crave more of that. But, you know, this is the thing that I'm struggling with, too. So
when you speak to Jim, and this will help this mom as well, like, what is the, when he is socializing, what do you talk about?
All kinds of things. Like, he'll bring up, he'll start a conversation. Usually it's around a YouTube video, because that's what he loves. He'll start telling me about this really funny video, and we'll laugh about that, and I'll add something into it. He adds something in, and then it branches up into other things.
Exactly.
Which is so exciting to me that that happens, because we prayed for that. Exactly. For years we prayed
and
for
that. And that, I think, is the key thing, is that it starts with having something that he's genuinely interested in.
Yeah.
And I think that's very, very important. And of course, with all of us, technology has taken a huge, plays a massive role in all of our lives, especially our children's lives. But the important thing with conversation is that it has to be, it will either be rote, which we can teach ways to kind of, you can teach rules. Like, for instance, you can say, a rule of during eating, you know, every three bites you have one conversational moment. Like you'll make one statement and expect one response. But that depends on the functioning of the child. Like there are children where we, of course, start teaching them rotation of conversation by asking a question, answering, asking a question, answering, or statement. You know that.
Like
taking turns in conversation is an aspect of conversation you teach. Body language and eye contact is an aspect we teach. But
want to say all of those lessons are in skills,
they
by the way.
Are. They
statement,
all are.
Statement, question. All of
there's
those
a whole
things,
section called social all, conversation
yeah,
and
it's
social
all skills.
Yeah. But all of that is just teaching the process, I guess, the process of conversation. It isn't, nevertheless, all of conversation really depends on one thing, which is the motivation to converse. And the motivation to converse is only really about, in regards to something we're interested in.
Yeah.
Like, I will talk to my daughters about a whole ton of things, and my son couldn't care less. He'll walk out of the room. But he brings his own interjection of things, which usually do also have to do with what's online or what's on his phone or something that happened with his friends or something that he noticed I was interested in last time it came up, you know, those types of things. And he'll talk about those things, and my kids will talk about those things. Why do they do that? They do that because they receive an adequate amount of reinforcement from our expressions and our responses. So if someone comes and says, oh, did you see that thing that was on YouTube? And your reaction as a parent is like, you're on your phone or you're busy and you're like, yeah, I saw it. You know, then they're not gonna do that again. So a lot of it has to do with your reaction being, I know, I want to see it again. Do you have it? Show it to me. Oh my God, I find that so funny. That is like, okay. And engaging and reinforcing that conversational piece. So first of all, identify the things that your child is interested in. Prompt those areas of conversation. You can certainly evoke a conversation by starting out on something like, I often go to Sonny and I'll show him also stuff that I've seen online that I think is hilarious, you know, which to him, it's never really hilarious, my stuff. But anyway, I still do, you know, and so you can evoke it by bringing up something of interest to them and then by being genuinely interested in what they bring to the table.
Wonderful. I thank you so much for
it's
everything
a pleasure.
That you add. It's just incredible this hour and how much I learned, and I know that you all feel that way as well.
Lots of fun.
Thank you so
thank
much.
You.
We're going to take a break now and go to the A word so we can take a look. We're back at the beginning of the series where the family is just starting therapy with Jack Riley, taking a look at what all the fears that evokes in the family. And then when we come back, it's time for Let's Talk Autism with Shannon and Nancy. Nancy Allspot Jackson is going to join me. Don't forget, our special guest today is Dan Healy, and we're going to be talking about the film Finding Joshua, which Nancy is an integral part of this story. So we'll fill you in on all that. But first, here is the A word.
big five hand. If everybody's agreed and held hands that early intervention is key, then I can't imagine why. If the original center knew on November 2nd that we didn't speak or make much noise at all during the evaluation, they knew that on that day. I can't comprehend for the life of me why it would even take a month to start speech therapy. That doesn't make any sense to me.
The waiting's hard.
The waiting's really hard. We read things about how the brain is so much more malleable the younger they are. You know, every day that ticks by just seems like a waste of time. You know, you go on the websites and you read all these things, and there's kind of a club, I think, of moms who call themselves autism warriors. And I hated that word when I first read it. I hated it. I still do. Because I don't, you know, there's a lot of things I wanted to fight for, but I didn't really have to fight for autism.
Yeah. It's okay, man. We're lucky in that he sprints to mom.
Okay, this is how my son reacts to me coming home. Oh, Jack Riley. Hi! Mommy's home! Mommy's home! Hello!
When he sprints to me when I get home, and he kisses you and hugs you. And,
where's my son?
One of the first people that I told when we got the diagnosis was a good friend of mine who knew somebody who had an adopted son who has autism. And had not only fought, talk about autism warrior, this woman founded a whole foundation and was extremely active and extremely knowledgeable, and my friend put me on the phone with her. She was the one who turned me on to both ADA and to CARD and to tell me how valuable it was, and we're very grateful for it because
yes.
We realized that had we not been given information, we never would have known. The original center would not have recommended that for us. So it required us to really, really push to get what we wanted. And I didn't know even until I asked the question if I had a choice. I thought this was great advice. Don't ever feel that you're at the mercy of the regional center because they're paying for your services. She told me, you're paying for your services. They're using tax money to do this and you've paid taxes. Intake at CARD was actually a much more pleasant experience than the regional center evaluation. I think in part because we'd been through it once and it wasn't as scary for us. It was a good experience for us because we felt like our son was himself. He had all the same things going on as far as autism was concerned, but he was still bright and happy and affectionate. I felt like he showed them both his good sides and the sides that he needs to work on. So for us, it felt good because we felt like at least people were seeing what we see. I felt maybe for the first time that they got it, that it's like, okay, he is this way, this is what he's got going on, but we can make this better. At first, it was exhausting to think that every single thing was a teaching moment, that every single thing that he did, and I know that, you know, I would say something to him and he'd be like, really? Can we just feed him? Can we just feed him dinner and we don't have to worry about it? But now even that's not as exhausting because it's sort of starting to become more natural for us so that it doesn't feel as awful.
Well, I remember feeling guilty just for being with him all day and then, you know, just sort of sneak the TV on to Sports Center in the afternoon and he's playing with his Legos and I just back up and lean against the sofa with him between my feet, but I wasn't really watching him. I would just try to watch Sports Center for a few minutes and then I'd always feel guilty and try to get over that.
So, no more guilt.
I think we're teammates. That's the best thing. I feel like she's on my side, I'm on her side.
We sort of, we've been lucky that my weak moments are his strong moments.
Well, on a personal note, is the camera still on?
It is.
On a personal note, I would be lost. She really dove in. And I mean, I've Googled autism, and I still don't understand it until she explains it to me.
Which is scary because I don't really understand it.
Well, that's the point. But she dives to the next step. And I'm just starting to understand the last step, and she's trying to explain the next step. And I told her last night I would be lost if she wasn't doing that, because I wouldn't, I don't think I could. Sometimes I'm reading these things and it just floats over me because I go numb again reading about it.
Well, I think, in fairness, I think one of drive. I think there's always somebody in every family who just takes that role.
Yeah. If somebody takes charge, take a back seat. That's the moral of that. Send him that too.
Here we are, as I'm jiggling with my equipment. Good morning, Shannon.
Good morning, and welcome to Let's Talk Autism with Shannon and Nancy.
I'm Nancy Allspaugh-Jackson.
And I'm Shannon Penrod. Everybody knows me.
Shannon Penrod Miller.
I don't do that.
You don't?
No.
I never legally changed my name.
I'm not hyphenated. No. I don't do that. I'm just Shannon Penrod.
Do you find it confusing with Jem being Jem Miller?
I did for a while, okay. But it, you know, and we still, what am I saying? We still have, insurance cards came yesterday labeling everybody Penrod, and we'd had to reorder new ones.
Yeah.
There are difficulties, but you know what? I promised my dad. I promised my dad when I was a teenager, my dad said to me that he said, you're so talented, you're going to do amazing things, kid. And he said, promise me you'll use the Penrod name. And I was like, done.
Yeah, well, I've never legally changed it. I just hyphenate just because, I don't know, I just thought, well, it's easier than with Wyatt being Wyatt Jackson and all that.
Yeah.
So, but anyway, it's legally just Nancy Allspaugh. Always has been.
Yeah.
Always will be.
There you go.
Yeah, there you go.
And I think for everybody, it's different things. I know other people who were thrilled to change their last name.
I never was subscribed to that.
I wasn't opposed to it. I just promised my dad. So it was cut and dried, not happening.
And then all the women that I know that have been married multiple times, every time they change their names, it's very confusing.
And you know, sometimes a name works better. There's already a very famous Shannon Miller gymnast who I could
never
be mistaken for.
That's true.
She has highways named after her. I don't want to encroach on that space.
All right. Anyway. Well, we have a really interesting show today.
We do. We have a very, and I've been telling people that you're a part of the story that we're going to unveil.
Right. Well, it's interesting because the topic of this hour is finding Joshua, and Joshua. I had to look back to see actually when this was. This was back in September of 2011. And there was a young boy with autism, most of you probably remember this story, big national news, named Joshua Robb. He was from the area of Lake Arrowhead, California. And he was lost. He was on the school ground when he was lost. He slipped through the bars, and his parents had lost custody. His father and stepmother had lost custody of Joshua after a Department of Social Services worker saw Joshua being tethered in the yard while the family was moving after being evicted from their home.
Yeah, if we all dial back, I mean, you know, you're seeing lots of movies right now like The Big Short. If we all dial back to that time, there was a lot of things going on where people were losing their homes with very short notice. And this family was being evicted from their home in one of these cases where they lost their home because it was part of a, you know, the loan changed as it did to a lot of people.
Right.
And they had to get out and get out quickly.
Right.
And they had a child with autism who eloped.
Who eloped. So they had him tethered in the yard, and we're going to go into this more in detail. And someone actually from the bank, I believe, called. We'll have to ask the filmmaker.
It was the realtor.
The realtor. Okay. And they came and they took Joshua from his family.
Said it was inappropriate that he was with a soft tether.
Right.
He was tethered to the house.
And
I'm sure it looked weird.
I'm sure it looked weird. And then the school tethered him.
Right. And he got out of the tether and went missing.
And went
missing
into the forest and was missing for more than 24 hours. And it was such an ordeal. And one of the main reasons it made national news was because the authorities blasted some of his favorite music, which included the song Ozzy Osbourne, a song by Ozzy Osbourne, called No More Tears, interestingly enough.
Yeah.
And Joshua was found. Joshua has since been reunited with his father and stepmother. And we're going to talk about all of this with a documentary filmmaker by the name of Dan Healy on a documentary he put together. So we're going to go to a promotional clip that will show you what's coming up. And when we come back,
We will be with Dan Healy, the documentarian who has made this film, Finding Joshua. Take a look, and then we'll go to break.
The housing bubble burst, and we, you know, in our business, we saw just a heck of a lot of homes go back to banks, and people lose their homes and dominoed into losing jobs, and it was a very, very difficult time for a lot of people.
We had tried to get a loan modification through Chase Bank on our house. They said we had 6 months, and in 5 months they were knocking on the door saying that our home had been foreclosed on. We couldn't find the teddy bear harness thing for children like they were using at school to walk in between classes so we didn't take off running, which is an elopement issue that most autistic children have. So she took a soft nylon webbing, loosely tied it around his waist and tied him to the deck post for 5 minutes.
One of the patrol deputies received a call from a realtor in Lake Arrowhead to go out to a residence where a child was tied up. The child was given to child, at the time it was known as Child Protective Services, and they placed the child.
There are lots of families that softly tether their children to keep them safe. Okay, you have a choice, tether my child in the front yard or let him run out into traffic and be killed.
We got a phone call from CPS saying that Joshua had gone missing from a school. That's when we found out that somehow he had slipped under a fence and went running off into the wilderness.
The foster family that had him, I believe one of them was there at the scene and said that he will likely run from us and that he was a runner, and I think that goes back to why Joshua was tied up back in August at the house in Lake Arrowhead.
What would you do if your child was hurting?
If your family's future was uncertain?
If help seemed out of reach?
Have you been given no hope?
Talk means I am not alone in this.
This is the reality for families affected by autism. And today, the number of children with autism is growing more rapidly than ever. Talker unites these families and shows that they do not have to fight this battle alone.
Our oldest son, Jared, who has autism, when we first took him to the doctor to get the diagnosis, you know, it's so sad because they offer you nothing. There's no help. There's no hope.
One of the things that you learn with autism is being very grateful for even the small milestones. You know, when you first get the diagnosis, you go through all the range of emotions. You know, this can't be happening. Why is this happening? You have to get to a point where it's the emotion that has to be leading is, what can I do? The first thing that struck me was walking to a room and seeing, oh my gosh, we're not alone. And there is this very strong community that's already set. And something I still today associate with TACA the most is hope. To me, that's what TACA means. TACA means hope.
It's like you've got all these dreams and goals of what your son's gonna do, and you get your diagnosis and you're sent home. And that's it. There's no plan of action. There's no, here's autism, here's what we're gonna do to make your life better and help him. It's strictly go home and try to process it and go on the internet. It was devastating. And you just, you know, you go through this 3 week of depression and then you snap out of it. You have to. And then you start making phone calls and trying to figure out what is autism and what are we gonna do. And then we found TACA, and it was life-changing.
Autism, there really is no definitive answer. It is trying to find the resources that are out there that can assist you to help your child so that, you know, you just don't feel so helpless at those particular moments.
There was direction, and there was hope, and there was a little ray of sunshine that he's gonna be okay, and we're gonna be okay. I always look back and think we would never be where we are. Carson wouldn't be where he is at without TACA.
So 13 years ago, my son was diagnosed with autism, and that put our whole family into a tailspin. There were so many different ideas and things that were not proven. Nobody knew what guidance to give us. We had no direction. And then we found TACA. They helped give us a path to follow, help give our son a better future and make him healthy and put him back onto the road of recovery. When your son's first diagnosed, the first thing you hope for is, gosh, I just want my son to speak. I just want to be able to communicate with him in some way. Then you want a little more. You want him to go to a regular school. Then you want him to potentially have a real life and go to college. So you're always hoping for the future of your child. My son is a happy, healthy, vibrant young boy that's going to turn 15 really soon. And we couldn't be more pleased. And without TACA, I don't think we'd be in the place that we are today. We believe the future is not defined for many affected by autism. There is hope and direction for these kids and their families. TACA is dedicated to providing community, support, education, and hope to families affected by autism.
At TACA.
At TACA.
At TACA.
We are families with autism helping.
Helping.
Helping families.
Helping families with autism.
Hi, my name is Matt. I am 19 years old, and I was diagnosed with autism when I was 6 years old. Autism is one of the fastest growing developmental disabilities in the United States, but I am living proof that with the right treatment, hope is possible. My future is not limited. Today, I am attending Fullerton Community College, and I run for the cross country team for fun with my friends. It makes me feel proud when I think about my progress. Chances are you know someone affected by autism. Show them they are not alone and help others get on the road to recovery. Contribute to Talk About Curing Autism today.
And we are back with Let's Talk Autism, and we are exploring a subject today that many of you may remember, the case of Joshua Robb, the young boy with autism who was taken from his family, put into foster care, subsequently eloped from a schoolyard, lost in the woods, in the deep woods of California. And this story is actually kind of what brought me and Shannon together to do this show, because there was a lot of interest in this because of this issue of tethering, that the family, the mother and father, when they initially lost Joshua Robb, custody of Joshua, and he was put into foster care, was because it was reported that he was tethered in the yard while they were being evicted from their home. They had him on a light tether, and then subsequently he was put in foster care, and then the school tethered him and lost him when he eloped into the mountains of California. I had been asked to come on KNBC and a few other shows to talk about this issue of tethering, which many families feel is the only option to keep their children safe. And it was then that I came as a guest on Autism Live, and Shannon and I, the rest is history.
We hit it off.
We hit it off, and we loved covering these issues and many others for you. So right now, I'd like to introduce the filmmaker of a documentary called Finding Joshua, Dan Healy. Dan, thanks for joining us today.
Thank you.
Good to have you here. Now, Dan, you are a business owner. You're a former magazine and newspaper editor, screenwriter, turned director and producer. Your screenplay, Gabriel's Bones, was a finalist in the screenplay search screenwriting contest, official selection of the New Hope Film Festival script competition. You semi-finalist in the Script of Pabalooza screenwriting contest. So you're a prolific screenwriter. And to learn the craft of filmmaking, you volunteered as an assistant and cinematographer on indie projects. And you've done everything from science fiction to documentary. You are the organizer of the Documentary Film Crew Meetup Group. Tell us, Dan, why you made this film, Finding Joshua.
Well, a friend of mine It alerted me to a story in the LA Times about the boy that escaped from the grade school up here in San Bernardino Mountains. I live in Green Valley Lake, excuse me, and Twin Peaks is not far from me, so I was quite interested in reading the story. And when I got to the last couple paragraphs, which is often the case with news stories and the papers, you know, the more interesting aspects appear at the end. And it seemed that he was running away from the grade school to find his parents. The parents had been foreclosed on. They had tied him lightly, tethered him lightly to a fence post. The realtor that had foreclosed on them had seen that and contacted Child Protective Services. Child Protective Services had removed the boy from the home.
Yeah, hey, look, can I interrupt you here, Dan, for a minute?
Yes. Uh-huh.
There was no prior history of abuse in the home or any record of DPS coming in for any reason. Is that correct?
That's right.
So simply because he was found lightly tethered in the yard, a realtor called and DPS swooped in and took this child, correct?
That's right.
Okay.
They asked no questions at all. They just removed him.
Okay. We'll talk a little bit more about whether this was a rush to judgment. All right. Continue on. Sorry to interrupt you there.
So, you know, our perspective on it then was that the boy had been looking for his parents. You know, he's not communicative, but that seemed obvious to us.
He was nonverbal.
He was nonverbal, although he, you know, he does say a few things. And apparently he said to a classmate that he was going to look for a policeman. And what I take from that was that he had been told if he's ever in trouble to look for a policeman. So that was his goal in leaving the school. Of course, he got lost into the national forest because the school was adjoining the forest. So, you know, it wasn't possible for him to find anybody.
And so you were intrigued with this situation because of what reasons, Dan?
Well, the story of the tethering, for one, the fact that he was an eloper, that the authorities didn't really understand the situation the parents were in. All of those aspects I thought were something worthy of exploration in a documentary.
I think one of the things that's intriguing about this story is that, I mean, there are elements of this story that everyone can relate to or that activate our imagination. You know, so often in the autism community, we talk about a story that transcends and gets to the people outside the autism community. And one of the things that really captured America's heart was one of the things that helped them to retrieve this child was that they played an Ozzy Osbourne tune, and that helped the child to come out of the woods. And that captured, I had people calling me who knew nothing about autism, but they were like, have you seen this? They're using Ozzy Osbourne to get this kid out of the forest. For me, as an autism parent who had just gone through two different occasions where my landlords lost the property that I was renting from them, and we had to move suddenly, and I had a child with autism, I was like, oh my gosh, this could have been me if I hadn't had a team of therapists helping me when we were having to move on very short notice. Mm-hmm. Like, I don't know. My child was eloping at that point. I don't know what I would have done. It's easy for people to judge and go, well, we don't tether people. But, you know, when your choice is that your child is going to run, and clearly this child proved that he is a runner, you know, what other choices do you have? And I think that, you know, for other people who were in the process of losing their home, it made them say, oh my gosh, I know what I'm going through. These people are dealing with autism, and you lose your child out the gate.
And these are people that don't have the financial means to immediately recover from this kind of change. We're going to go to a clip. And Shannon, thanks for sharing your personal, you know, relationship with this, because it is something that, I think you're right, it touches on so many issues, not just the elopement, but also the financial crisis that we had back in, you know, 2009, 2010, where so many were evicted. We couldn't hold on to our home. We weren't foreclosed on, but ultimately had to.
And it continues today. Let's not make it sound like it's not happening now. This is happening to families. And in this next clip, we get to see the reality of they're moving out of their home, and there's this scene takes place in a U-Haul trailer
where they were living while they were, you know, trying to find a place
with a
to
child
actually live.
On the spectrum.
So let's take a look at the Joshua in the U-Haul having a hard time with it.
This is my 8.5-year-old autistic son, Joshua. And we are in the back end of a U-Haul trying to move things. And this is how he is acting, to not being able to go into his home and sleep in his bed. Because we are moving things. And cannot stay here. And he is very, very upset and not handling it well at all. Yeah, the boy ain't taking it though. Joshua is just, he's heartbroken, he does not understand. And his autism right now I just quiet him down by lighting a candle. And it seems to, yeah, he's calm for the moment. But yes, he's not handling it well at all and doesn't understand, and it's making the moving and loading very, very difficult. But he's wearing himself out. I believe he's at the end of his fit, but he's concentrating on the candle flame. So, maybe, yes, wonderful. The sight of a candle flame calming the boy.
Welcome back. We have with us Dan Healy, the filmmaker behind this film, Finding Joshua. And I was just saying to Nancy during the break that clip is so devastating to me, because as we were going through being evicted from both of the homes that we were evicted from, this was my worst fear. That we, at one point, things were so dire because we were trying to find affordable housing where we were and stay in the same school district, because my son was in kindergarten already and he had an aide, and we'd fought so hard for that.
Right.
And we'd been paying our rent. We were fine, upstanding citizens paying our rent, but our landlord wasn't, and so the home was foreclosed on. It was a condo. And at one point, in desperation, we went and looked at campers. And we said, you know, maybe we need to like get a camper to stay in. And I remember turning to my husband with tears in my eyes, saying, how are they going to do therapy in a camper? And, you know, and honestly, at one point I started picturing us in the back of a U-Haul, honestly. And the thing that's amazing to me now is that, you know, losing your home, you would think is the worst thing that could happen to you. You know, being with your child in the back of a U-Haul, you would think that's hitting bottom. And then just a couple of days later, they took him away. You would think, oh my gosh, they took my child away to foster care. That's the worst thing that could happen. But then, nightmare of nightmares, then the people who are responsible for him lose him into the Los Angeles forest. Oh my goodness. That's a story. And the fact that it all came out okay,
it's a miracle.
It is a miracle. So anyway, I just wanted to say that scene is just devastating.
It's gut-wrenching.
Devastating.
So Dan, we're going to go to a brief clip of the Robs responding to being accused of child cruelty, and then we're going to come back and talk about, for a few minutes, the limitations of foster care in the system. So let's go to that clip first.
Okay. During the time I was returning the U-Haul, Trish was left alone with him. He had tried taking off, running from him about five times, and we couldn't find the teddy bear harness thing for children like they were using at school to walk in between classes, so he didn't take off running, which is an elopement issue that most autistic children have. So she took a soft nylon webbing, loosely tied it around his waist, and tied him to the deck post for 5 minutes while she moved these two boxes of glasses and dishes out of his way so he didn't fall on him and get hurt. I came back from the U-Haul. I saw him there. He slipped. He saw me. He slipped right out of it. I mean, it wasn't tied tightly or anything like that. But during those 5 minutes, the realtor, who was part of stealing our property from us, saw it and called the sheriffs on us and said we had him tied up. To be arrested for child cruelty is just unreal to us, because we were never, ever cruel to our son. We love him dearly with all our heart. Our whole life evolved
around
doing things for Joshua. You know, he's my only son. I couldn't believe that was
happening
to us.
Mm. Very hard to see this couple's pain at being accused of child cruelty for the young son with autism that they clearly cared so deeply about. And in your coverage doing the documentary, did you find any evidence, Dan, that the Robs had in any way been cruel to Joshua or had not been fit parents?
No, not at all. They seemed like very attentive parents. There were other issues that led to them being arrested. Have to acknowledge that.
Okay.
There was some evidence of marijuana use, mm-hmm. and I believe amphetamine use of some kind. Mm-hmm. So that was the reason that they were arrested and put in jail for a short period.
Mm-hmm.
So that added to the equation, but basically it was they're trying to cope with, such a difficult situation.
And I think it's important for us to all mention, and I apologize for interrupting you, that I don't think that any of us here are advocating even soft tethers for children. Mm-hmm. I don't think that any of us are saying, oh, yay, let's all run out and do that.
No.
But, you know, I think what needs to be acknowledged by the system and by everyone is that there are some extraordinary circumstances that autism families face. And when you pile other things on top of that, I simply would ask everyone in that circumstance, if you don't have a support team to help you, what do you do if your child is going to run into the woods? And he clearly showed that he did and would. What do you do if you are forced to move and have no other circumstances?
What options do you have?
Yes.
And then, the other thing there was the school had tethered him as well at lunchtime.
Exactly. Yes. Anytime walking in between classes.
Yeah. So here the school itself, the authorities themselves who are taking the child away for being tethered are tethering the child. So that's sort of the ultimate in hypocrisy, I would think. Let's talk then about the fact that he was put in foster care. And Dan, from your exploration in your documentary, what kind of things did you learn about the limitations of foster care, particularly when it comes to children with autism or children with disabilities?
Well, Ron talks about it in the documentary. There were people on the mountain here. It's a very close-knit community. And there were people on the mountain that were willing to take Joshua. But what the child services did at that time was to remove him to a facility in Temecula, which is a different county, 50 miles away. Joshua had no interaction with any of the people he was familiar with. And that I think was the worst aspect, because there were so many people willing to step in and help, especially after the story get well known here in the press. That's by removing him from the environment that he was familiar with. I think they harmed him, not intentionally, but I think they harmed him.
Well, I have to say that I was trying to get Joshua help during this time after he had been found and put into the foster care, back into foster care. And the people at the facility in Temecula spoke to me, but after repeated efforts to ask them if we might help Joshua with behavior therapy to help him learn not to elope, and that we would actually come there with our team of therapists, we never got a response. And I recorded the attempts to reach them by telephone and by email, and their lack of responsiveness, basically, to that, which was, to me, rather shocking, because we were doing nothing but trying to help with a grant to get him therapy through CARD, our CARD SOS program. And so it does seem like he was sort of put into a situation that certainly was not an improvement on where he was in the home.
No, and you can't expect foster parents to have the expertise to deal with an autistic child.
Mm-hmm. Did you get a sense of how many children with autism might be in the foster care system?
I don't.
Okay. I imagine it's a large number.
Yeah, well,
I would think so, yeah.
I can speak to the fact that a little over a year ago, my husband and I went and had a meeting to try to begin adoption proceedings in the Los Angeles area. And when I asked the person that we sat with and talked about, you know, are there kids, the phrase that she used, a person in the LA adoption arena said, those kids are unadoptable.
Mm.
And I asked what supports, and she said, we don't have, I said, what behavioral supports? We don't have behavioral supports. It's a real issue. It's a problem.
Yeah. Well, as we all know, Joshua was found. We're going to take a brief break, and we're going to come back to a very gripping moment that Dan covers in the film, where Rob talks about how Joshua was found. So we're going to take a brief break, and we'll be right back with Dan Healy and more on Finding Joshua.
Hi, I'm Shannon Penrod, and we're at the ABCs and XYZs of Special Needs Conference. And this year, for the first time, they've got something really remarkable. It's the Entrepreneurial Boutique. These are all items that have been made and are being sold by individuals who have special needs. So we're going to do a little shopping and talk to some of these fabulous entrepreneurs. Come on.
My name is Molly Rarick, and I'm founder of Breeds Gift. We're a nonprofit that serves teens and adults with special needs, like Chase here. We were founded in 2013 and serve people in the Conejo Valley, Santa Barbara, and LA.
Our main objective is to give our participants the skills they need to gain a more independent life.
My name is Shelley Cox, and Lisa Zalagi and I are founders of Creative Steps and Create Micro Business Enterprises. And the items that we're selling here today are all made by the clients who have passions about what they want to make, and then they get the profits from what they make after we've paid all of the other expenses.
We are here today because my goal is to be independent, and also I would like to share all my artwork, and I would like to sell.
Thinking about at his young age being a businessman, you know, it's amazing. I cannot be more proud.
Detective Carpenter pulled me away and said, okay, look, this is what we need you to do. I said, I want to go out there and look for him. And he basically said, you can't do that because We may have to call in bloodhounds, being that you two are father and son, you may share the same DNA. You could throw off the scent of the bloodhounds. We can't do that. But we need your help on any ideas that you could give us on how to help find him. So after we got back to the sheriff's station, I basically gave them two CDs. I said, well, play some of his favorite music. They asked me, how can we pull him out? If he's hiding somewhere, how can we get him out in the open or the rescuers find him? I said, play some of his favorite music on loudspeakers. And they said, well, what's that? And I said, well, here, this CD, Alan Jackson's Good Time. I go, this CD, Ozzy Osbourne, No More Tears. A couple of his favorite videos to watch and songs. When we were out there, I heard the kids playing. I could hear them out in the playground from a school. And then around the corner came this U.S. Forest Service truck, and it started playing Ozzy's No More Tears. I instantly went down on my knees, bawling my eyes out, said a prayer, said, Dear Lord, please let him be found safe and alive. You know, we'll change our ways, we'll become, you know, better people and all that.
We're back, and that was a clip from the documentary Finding Joshua, and with us is Dan Healy, the filmmaker, and the very emotional Dan there. We see Ron Robb responding to how they found Joshua, which was extraordinary and really captured the nation's attention. They played some of his favorite music, including Ozzy Osbourne's No More Tears. Can you tell us a little bit about the times leading up to finding him and what they did?
Well, they were concerned that he might run away from rescuers. Turns out when they did find him, he did come out of the bushes and presented himself, but they were concerned, so they thought that rather than be yelling his name, they would play his favorite music so that he would come to the come to the people that were searching for him. And Ozzy Osbourne's No More Tears was used, and Ozzy was quite delighted when he heard that. He has actually talked about it in his own documentaries.
And this is something now that a lot of law enforcement agencies are using when a child with autism is missing. They just last month, there was a child who was missing who unfortunately was not found alive, but the police asked the parents almost immediately, what's his favorite song? And they were playing it all over the community as they were going through the community trying to find him. And I really believe it's because this captured everyone's attention and it was so successful. And there have been other successes of law enforcement being able to lure a child out because of that. It isn't always successful, obviously. It can't always be successful. But it's kind of an amazing story.
Yeah, it really is. And Dan, where are we today with this story? Because Joshua was not immediately put back into the custody of his parents, was he?
No, it was almost 3 years before he was reunited with his parents. They do have him now. They have a nice apartment in Twin Peaks. Joshua is going to school. The school that he had escaped from is now closed, so they have him in a separate school, in special education classes.
And we've got some clips from the documentary here. Kelby, can you just kind of roll those under as we're talking about this, showing Joshua reunited with his family. And looking happy again with his familiar toys. We have him here with his playing guitar and watching videos and obviously very comfortable swimming with his dad. So he is now reunited with his family. And how is he doing, Dan?
He's doing well. He doesn't have the one-on-one attention that he needs. The Robb family's car isn't in such great shape. You know, coming up the mountain here, they live at close to 6,000 feet. You know, it's difficult on vehicles. And the only one-on-one help that he could get would be in San Bernardino. So that hasn't happened yet. But they, but he's older, less likely to run. And the family seems to be doing very well.
What do you think we've learned from this, Dan? I mean, you took the time to make a documentary about this. What do you think we've learned?
Well, what I learned from making the documentary was just how difficult it is for families dealing with these problems, especially without a lot of help. People are very well-meaning up here, but they don't have the expertise. And our emphasis in the documentary is the reason we use so many family films is we wanted to show what it was actually like, give people the experience of their lives, and hope to elicit some empathy for children that are in that for children and families that are in that situation.
Yeah, so many families, I can tell you, as executive director of ACT Today, Autism Care and Treatment Today. So many families suffering across America, here in our own country, that have to make the choice between putting food on the table or therapy and treatment for their children or paying rent. And it's unfortunately not an uncommon situation, but very common. And a huge problem here in America, underprivileged families with children with autism that aren't getting the care and treatment they need and deserve that you cover so beautifully in this documentary. Yes. What are your plans for this film, Dan, and what have you been doing with it to get it out into the public?
And how can people see it?
Yes. Yeah.
Okay, well, we have submitted to film festivals, and hopefully some local festivals will show the film. But it is available to watch online. It's password protected. That's the rules of some of the festivals don't allow us to, you know, publicly make it available publicly. But if anyone wants to watch it, they can contact me. We have a website. It's called findingjoshuadocumentary.com. That's all strung together. And the last page, my phone number, email address is on there. They can contact me, and I can give them the link to watch the movie and the password.
Okay.
Well, it's
great.
An important film, and is there any takeaway from this that you feel, any solutions that you feel personally as a filmmaker that saw this situation firsthand and really explored it? Anything that our political leaders, that we as citizens, anything that could be done to remedy this?
Well, I think the most immediate thing would be for Child Protective Services, or what they're called, you know, what it's called now is Children and Family Services. If they could talk to the experts, find out how they should deal with children with autism, how they should cooperate with the family rather than make the family jump, you know, hurdles to get their child back. I think that would be the first thing to do. And of course, the government would need to fund that.
Mm-hmm. Okay, well, thank you so much, Dan, for joining us today. The film is Finding Joshua. Please take a moment, if you can, to watch it. It's a very powerful documentary and explores some very important issues for families with dealing with children with autism, particularly those that are economically disadvantaged, which is so many families. Thank you for joining us today, Dan.
And we're going to be right, thank you, Dan, and we're going to be right back in just a few minutes talking about an arts festival that's happening this week that features some very important people's artwork, one of them, Wyatt Jackson.
Yes, I get it.
So stick with us.
Hello, fellow activists. In our last segment, we talked about step number two. Educate yourself.
Step number three is get support. Now, any journey can feel overwhelming if you feel like you're walking it alone. Well, you're far from alone, because with 1 in 50 kids diagnosed with autism today, there are a lot of us out there. Of course, there's always the issue of financial support. Now, there's a handful of organizations out there that offer financial support to families in need. ACT Today, or Autism Care and Treatment Today, is one of them. Visit our website at www.act-today.org to find out more about our grant process. I want to talk about a different kind of support today, emotional support. Now, you can get that from other travelers on this path. Some of the best advice I've ever received is from the moms of other kids with autism who went to school with Wyatt or were involved with programs with him. Then there are the pioneers. These are the families that have gone through this years ago, and there was very little information out there. All of these people seem to have the desire to pay it forward. Now, one of them, Lisa Ackerman, who is one of my mentors, started an organization called TACA, Talk About Curing Autism. She actually took the concept of mentors and support groups and made it available to everybody. You can go to their website, talkaboutcuringautism.org, to find out more. During the first and most difficult year after Wyatt's diagnosis, I wrote an email to close family and friends, letting them know what was going on and the challenges our family was facing and why we dropped out of sight. I was amazed at the outpouring of love and affection and all the help I received from that email. First, you have to be vulnerable. You can't be afraid to ask. Try this out. Could you cook me a meal? Are you going to the market? Can you pick me up a few things? Could your kids play with my kid and make them feel included? Or can you come over and clean my house? Well, maybe not that last one, except with your best friend. And maybe the best support of all is having someone that listens, and that doesn't cost a dime. So until next time, surround yourself with the loving kindness of others and keep the faith. And we are back.
Yes, and there's an event that was rescheduled from a couple of weeks ago because we've had some on and off rain here in Los Angeles.
Yes, and it is Arts and Crafts of Autism. It's going to be in Venice Beach. And it's
this Saturday is when it's rescheduled.
This
for.
Saturday from 9 to 4 is my understanding, and we're going to give you the website in just a bit. Brighter Future Charity wants to invite everyone in our community to attend this event, a way of giving hope and inspiration to families affected by autism that have individuals with autism that have one of a kind paintings, handmade jewelry, and all kinds of artistic creations.
And one of those artists.
And one of those artists is the one and only Wyatt Jackson. And Kelby, I think I sent you some pictures here. First of all, there's Wyatt painting today. That's his little art corner. You see Picasso there, and that's one of his paintings. And this is what he does with, Wyatt does this with about 50% of his free time, is he paints. And Kelby, do you have the picture of what? Okay, so as you can see, my son had an inclination for art. Wasn't he yummy?
Yes.
At a very early age.
He's still yummy.
And we have some of his creations, which we call Echo Art. Here are Starbucks cartons that he has painted, egg cartons, and that's an umbrella stand carton that he painted. That's a detail of one of the Starbucks cartons that he did. And that's a cross we made for Easter out of the Starbucks cartons. We strung them together.
It's so clever. And it's beautiful what he does. But, you know, my head goes to, how did it occur to you to have him paint a Starbucks carton?
It
that
didn't.
Would never have occurred to
it
me.
It didn't occur to me. He did it.
How funny. He just went and got it off
I
the
I had Starbucks cartons, and he went and got it off the counter.
Oh,
and great. The egg cartons, I think I had an egg carton sitting around, and he went and started painting it. And then I had wine cartons. His wine cartons are magnificent.
Uh-huh.
And we're calling it Why Art
by
Echo artist Wyatt Jackson. So we will have some of Wyatt's Why Art there and be selling it, because it is all from recycled materials.
Wow.
And They are seeking volunteers, by the way. They need 8 volunteers from 9 to 12:30 and 10 volunteers, 12:30 to 4, art buddies. They'll manage and play alongside others at the Make Your Own Arts and Crafts table. Sounds like something up your alley. Help with the raffle and prizes and partner with one of our brilliant artists as a buddy.
And they will, if you volunteer, it says that they will happily provide lunch for
yes,
you.
So, yes. So we, Amy and I will be there, and Wyatt. And Andrea, who is organizing this, Andrea Clark, can be reached at Andrea@FlorentinaSong.com.
Okay.
That's Andrea@FlorentinaSong.com. And her number, she can be reached direct at 310-309-1858. That's 310-309-1858. And Kelby, do we have the website, brighterfuturecharity.org? There it is, Brighter Future. I'll read it to you. It's just all one word, brighterfuturecharity.org, which will tell you how to get there. Has a map and everything. And, you know, some of you may need community service hours. I'm sure this would certainly count towards
Absolutely.
That.
Absolutely.
If you're a college student or a high school student or junior high, elementary, and you would like to come get community service hours, I'm sure that would be a way. And just come support. It's going to be a fun day.
Absolutely. I want to go back to the cross. Kelby, is okay. there any way you can bring the cross back up? So he decided himself that he was going to do the egg cartons. Did he decide to put them in the shape of a cross, or did mom decide to put
mom
them in?
Mom decided it would make, mom said, let's try to string some of these egg cartons together and make a design. And we decided, well, what's a simple design? A cross. And it was Easter time. And that's, by the way, about 5 feet by 5 by 3.
It's really beautiful. And I have to say, you know, you are very artistic. I remember going into your home and you had a bunch of art that was around that was different things. And you know, I was just noticing all of it. But there was one thing in particular that really caught my eye, a bust of a head that sat on an end table. And I was like, this is lovely. It's my favorite thing. In the whole house, and Nancy was like, oh, I did that. In my period when I was doing X, Y. And like, I was so impressed. There are other things though that are in your home that are the artwork of
mostly
your...
personal. My husband's mother,
yes.
Was an artist, Angela Troya, a prolific artist of all different realism and also modern art. Mm-hmm. And Reed is actually quite an artist.
Oh, see, now I didn't know that.
Yes, he sketched a beautiful portrait of his father that we have hanging up. And I went through a phase after I got out of my television, finished my television career, where a group of women and I started what we called The Colony.
Uh-huh.
And we painted. It was our therapy, and we got together 3 days a week and painted rather prolifically, and we put on several art shows of The uh-huh. Colony. And so there are a lot of paintings around the house that I've done, but I haven't had the time to paint over the last couple of years. I hope to one day get back to it. One day I see myself as a, you know, 80-year-old woman up in the mountains somewhere painting and writing and just letting my creative freak flag fly.
We can't wait for that day. But I have to say, too, I think there is a sensibility that you also know how to put things together. And so I think Wyatt's very lucky to have you as a mom to have recognized and have let this flourish in him. He is already an amazing painter, and I know this is just like one of many shows to come.
Well, we need to get a website, and we need to get a Facebook page, and I haven't had time to do that.
But
I am representing.
But the art
if you
is there.
Want his art, you can call me. And anyway, you know, I often say to you, well, Jem's so talented at computers, and that you're so lucky in that it's such a high-tech world, and maybe he'll find employment in that, and, you know, maybe he'll be a coder or design games, and, oh, my son's an artist. Gee, that really pays well.
Which sings to me. Like, that makes much more sense to me. I think that's wonderful. Of course he's going to be an artist. It's his passion. He said the other day that he, you know, he gets up and he has his list of things that he wants to do in the morning before he goes to school.
He has to paint.
Have his coffee and paint. That's passion.
He makes a big pot of coffee, decaf, and he then after he gets dressed, he paints for about 10 minutes or he will not walk out the door. And it's one of the first thing he does when he comes home in the afternoon and the last thing at night. So I think there's a lesson in this, which is for all of us as parents, as much as I'd like him to be a computer genius, he's not. And we have to follow their bliss.
Yep.
We don't impose our passions on our children. Most of their passions are there. So particularly I think for kids on the spectrum, pay attention to what they love, because whatever it is they do repetitively can possibly be shaped and molded into a career.
Absolutely.
If not a career, at least a passion that will be tremendously satisfying for them. And so for me, my kid's an artist. That's just who he is. He's a visual artist. And when I say to him, I used to say, what do you want to be when you grow up? Do you want to be an artist? He'd say, I already am an artist.
There you go. And that's the truth. Unfortunately, we're out of time. I want to remind everybody that tomorrow we are doing a show and we are going to have Jim the Trim, the barber in England who got down on the floor, cut that boy's hair, and you wait till you see what he's doing now. It's going to blow your mind. We're out of time, but until then, give your kiddos a hug from me.
And give yourselves a hug from me.
Bye-bye for now.